Hey, it's Jason again from Fraser Valley Rose Farm. Well, it's mid-December now, and if you look behind me, you can probably see most of my roses have gone dormant for the winter. That's my stock field back there. So it's not a great time for me to show you any fabulous looking roses, but it is still a good time of the year to consider propagation. So what I'm going to show you today is a method of hardwood cuttings I've been working on. Now, I did make a video last year on hardwood cuttings where I did those in the ground in my greenhouse, and you can review that for instructions as well. But this version of hardwood cuttings goes entirely without soil, which is kind of great for me. I can do that inside, I can do it without the chance of soil contaminating the cuttings, and so far it's worked extremely well. Now, the way I tried it was in the summer, under controlled temperatures. This time I'm doing it in the winter, which I don't think will be any worse in terms of results, but I guess we'll see. If anything, I would think the winter cuttings should be better prepared because that's their more natural cycle for hardwood cuttings. So stay tuned. I'm going to go grab in the field some long stems of some varieties I still want to propagate from, and then I'll bring you inside and show you how the method goes. So these are the stems that I collected from out in my garden just now, and mid-December, everything out there should be what they call fully ripened, meaning it's hard. It's firmed off for the winter, and it did that on its own. So you can feel on this, and I know you can't feel it, but I can sure feel it, that if I try to bend that, it barely takes a bend. In fact, it feels like it would snap. You also want to make sure that you're picking wood that is from the same year of growth as this one. So you're not looking for previous years of growth. And sometimes you'll see across the bottom here, a bigger, thicker stem like that. That there is probably from the previous year of this plant's growth. And thicker and harder like that. Typically, I don't have good results trying to take hardwood cuttings from that section. So I stick to this here, which was from the same year of growth. Now, to talk about fully ripened, I just pulled one example from the field, and it's hard to find in December, of something that was silly enough to send up softwood at this time of year. And you can see this one here is very, very soft, very, very bendy, and wholly inappropriate for trying to take a hardwood cutting. That's softwood or semi-hardwood. What we're looking for is the fully firm, fully ripened wood from the same year of growth. Next, we'll talk about what is the length that you want. And I did cover all of this in my previous video on hardwood cuttings, but since I'm doing hardwood cuttings again, may as well show you again. So you're looking for something that they say is about the thickness and length of a pencil, with at least 3 or maybe 4 nodes on it. So if I looked at this one here, the nodes are the places where the leaves came out. It's a little bump on the stem there. I hope that shows up on camera. So I'm going to cut just below that node there. And then I'm going to go up to about the length of a pencil. And you could go at that one there, that's another node right there. Or you could go all the way up to this one here. And that is approximately a good hardwood cutting. I'm going to repeat that process a couple more times on camera here, just so you can see how I'm selecting those. This one here, I don't want to go quite as thick as it is at the bottom of the stem here, so I'm going to start up here. And again, going up to about the length of a pencil, I'm going to choose this one here. The next node was a lot further along. This one here, I've got a node down here. And good time to make sure your pruners are nice and sharp before you do this. Those two there are a little bit shorter than I'd like to go. That's closer to the average length I'd like to pick. And maybe I'll do one more here. This one here actually still has the leaf sticking out of it. And so you can see, strip those off. Definitely will strip off any dormant leaves before you do this portion here. So there I have 4 appropriate hardwood cuttings. The next part I'm going to do here is I'm going to dip them in rooting hormone. In this case, I'm using the powder. And And an important thing is that even after you've put the powder on the bottom there, you need to tap it off. Please don't leave a whole ton of powder on the bottom of your stems. And because I just took the cutting, I know which way is the top and which one is the bottom. But if I were taking these cuttings to these lengths out in the field, I might give a curved cut to the top of the cutting, just so that I can tell which is the different one when they get inside here. Okay, up to this point, this has been exactly the same method as I used for rooting the hardwood cuttings outdoors. Where it differs is that instead of putting these into the ground, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put them into a food container like this one here. This is just a styrofoam food container. Could use plastic or whatever. And I'm going to close that up, and that has the name of the variety printed on the top there. Okay, so this is where it becomes the soilless method. And I picked this up on one of the Rose forums where they talked about the burrito method or the newspaper method. And what they took is a damp piece of newspaper, and mind you, not a wet piece of newspaper, but a damp piece of newspaper, and prepared the cuttings and then rolled them into a damp piece of newspaper and put it into a plastic bag and left it in a cool place for a length of time to allow the cuttings to callus. That's what I'm after in here. If I come back to this in, say, 4, 5, 6 weeks, and I start to see a little bit of callus forming on the bottoms of those cuttings, that's a good thing. I adapted the newspaper method because I tried it, and what I found is that as much as I wrung out that newspaper to try to get that dampness out of it, my cuttings were still very prone to rotting. So you're going to lose your cuttings in one of two different ways. They are either going to rot, in which case what you would start to see on these cuttings here is you'd start to see blackness either on the thorns or prickles, I guess, the bottom or the top. Usually you'll see blackness start to come up and down the stem. So they will either rot like that, or the second way that you'll lose them is if they dry out and you'll see them starting to shrivel and lose their moisture. So those are the two basic ways that you're going to lose your cuttings. And really, I don't know of any other ways that I've ever lost my cuttings, either by rotting or by drying out. So this method is intended to stop both of those things. Now, you might be saying right now, well, that this here is not going to stop them from drying out. Well, this is not the final stage of the method. I'm going to get together a few of these, and then I'll show you the next part here. So my method of maintaining moisture for the cuttings is to place them into an outer bin. The inner bin here is not airtight. There's lots of gaps and holes in this to allow the moisture from the air in the outer bin to get in and to keep these cuttings from drying out. So as you can see, the outer bin here, I've sprayed the inside of that. I'm also going to spray the lid. So I've got the lid here. Spray that down, keep it moist. Once I seal this, the humidity inside of there should be at 100% without the cuttings being directly wet. And I found that in losing cuttings by this method, if I keep the cuttings wet at all, if I place them into the inner bin wet at all, then I will lose some due to rotting. But in all of the time that I trialed this in the summer, I did not lose any of my cuttings due to them drying out. So it appears that the outer bin and inner bin method is effective in maintaining the moisture of those cuttings. I want to show you one more thing, and that's how I maintained temperature when I did this during the summer. It might not be such an issue now because it's winter, it's at low temperature down here in the basement, but during the summer I had to do something special to keep the temperature right. All right, as mentioned, in the method they shared on the Rose Hybridizers forum, the newspaper technique or the burrito technique, they had to recommend a temperature around 15 degrees Celsius kind of as a constant. And that is kind of a challenge during the summer when you're doing this kind of hardwood cuttings. So what I did is I placed this into my flower cooler, and nobody ever gets to see my flower cooler. So here it is. I have an air conditioner into the side of this large wooden, almost like a chest freezer. And this temperature controller up here tells me that it's currently 7.6 degrees in here. That's plenty cold enough. But in the summer, I can go and adjust this so that I want to get a lower temperature, and that will turn on the air conditioner, and it maintains it at that 15 degrees that I need. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to try this method during the summer. So if you want to try this method during the winter, you don't have to do anything special like this. But if you're trying it during the summer, you'll have to find a way to try to control the temperature on the outer box. So those are my adaptations to the hardwood cutting technique, Soilless Method, adapted from the Rose Hybridizers Forum. I hope you enjoyed the video. I'm definitely going to have to update you with the results with the new video as I see how this turns out over the winter. My summer results were quite good and quite promising. What I found is that as opposed to the outdoor soil technique, which was not only a lot dirtier, but also a lot more prone to either drying out or rot. And in the outdoor technique, I had about a 50% success rate or slightly below that. With this method here, early results showed that I could callus at least up to 70 or 80% of all the different varieties that I put in. And it really was varietal. Some varieties did very well, some varieties did very poorly. So I'll update you with videos, and thanks for watching.